Hello and welcome to your video on ancient China. Now, ancient China, it's a civilization that developed along the Yellow River. And the Yellow River, it's kind of special because the soil is very fertile. It's because of the desert to the west mixing with the water from the Yellow River. It makes this very, very loose but very, very fertile soil. And because of this loose and fertile soil, the Yellow River, it's very prone to flooding. It floods often, it's dangerous. The river frequently changes course because of the flood, but it's still very, very good fertile soil to grow in. So this is going to become the cradle of Chinese civilization. Other parts of the geography of China, there's mountains to the west, there's jungle to the south, there is desert to the north and the west, and then there's steeps or steppes to the north and the east. So China's going to be fairly well protected from outsiders, which allows this Chinese culture to develop. Now, Chinese history is typically told in dynasties, so I'm going to go over a couple of the major dynasties with you. The first is the Xia, and the Xia, they're traditionally dated to from 2205 to 1776, and they're semi-mythical. There's only a little bit of archaeological evidence to support them. They are reported in ancient Chinese history books. There's the mention of somebody named Ya the Great, but there's no record of the Xia in the Shang dynasty, and the Shang were their successors, if you will. Now, the Shang, we know for sure they're real. They existed and ruled from 1766 to 1050 BC. And the reason we know about them is because we discovered in the 1920s their capital city of Anyang. We know that they were ruled by warrior horsemen. We know they left oracle bones that they used to tell their future and decide what was going on, etc., etc. they're a city-state based society. There was a king who had overall authority. Their cities were mostly built of wood, and this is because they were frequently moved due to war, due to floods, etc., etc. The king was very wealthy. He had hundreds of servants, hundreds of soldiers. And these servants and soldiers were sacrificed and buried whenever the king died. Their religion, we have a little bit of evidence of that. We know they recognized a deity above. They had lesser deities in nature. There was sacrifice and prayers made to their ancestors who then would talk to their gods for them. This is known as ancestor worship. Their kings were high priests, but their kings were not divine. And there's this emphasis on astronomy, celestial occurrences, magic, religious rites, you name it. Following the Shang are a group known as the Western Shu. And the Western Shu are going to take over in 1122, and they're going to go to 771. Now, you might notice there's a little bit of overlap, and that's because the Shu were invaders from Western China. They killed the last Shang king in 1050 and then become the undisputed rulers. Now, they rule using something called feudalism, and Chinese feudalism is not that different from European feudalism. The king gives land to a lord, and that lord becomes known as a vassal. Now, very often in Chinese culture, the vassal is a relative or somebody who has shown great valor, great intelligence, something like that, to help the king. Now, it's all done through legal contracts, and in exchange for being given land, the vassal gives his allegiance to the king. The vassal pays taxes to the king, and the vassal defends the king's lands. The Western Shu come up with this idea called the Mandate of Heaven. And it's this new idea that includes the first Chinese use of heaven as an idea. basically, the easiest way to describe this is the king gets his powers from heaven. And that means that there is a higher power that the king has to answer to. And the king must act morally. If the king does not have good morals, and if the king does not do what's best for his people, he could then lose the mandate of heaven. And if the king lost the mandate of heaven, he could be replaced by a new dynasty. So heaven is linked to the king. The king is subservient to something, and the king must work for the good of the people. Now, in reality, this mandate of heaven was used whenever one dynasty was toppled and a new one replaced it. Basically, the new king would say, we got rid of the old king, we killed him off because he wasn't doing the right thing. He lost the mandate of heaven, and he needed to be replaced. Speaking of being replaced, we have the Eastern Shu. The Eastern Shu, they're called this not necessarily because it's a different dynasty, but because the Shu dynasty is under attack. Over time, the Shu kings give away so much land that the vassals gained more and more political power, until at some point the vassals actually held more land than the kings. On top of that, the bureaucrats, the scribes, all of them began to grow influence. So you've got the king who's supposed to have the most political power. You have these bureaucrats who have a large amount of influence. And then you have these vassals who are saying, you know what, I'm actually more important than the king. So the king's forced to leave his capital. He has to move eastward for safety, and war breaks out when the king leaves. And this is a long period of warfare, and it's broken down into two sections. There's the spring and autumn period, which goes from 771 to 481 BC, and then the Warring States period that goes from 481 BC to 256 BC. In the spring and autumn period, the feudal system breaks down. These lords start to fight with each other, and the king is forced to flee to the east. Then in the Warring States period, that's when full-on open warfare breaks out. There were war 3 out of every 4 years, and basically what started out as 100 feudal states fight, it's like Chinese Survivor. In the last couple years of the war, there are 7 that exist, and by the end of the Warring States, there's only 1 survivor. That one survivor is named Xin Shi Huang Ti. He's the winner of the Civil War, and he and his people are the skilled horsemen from far west China. Now, Xin Shi Huang Ti is going to completely end feudalism, because that's what got China into this whole mess to begin with, and he institutes this policy known as legalism. And the easiest way to understand legalism, it's this idea that all must serve the state. It creates a powerful centralized state. It rejects ethics, it rejects history, and it's based on a system of strict, impartially applied, detailed laws. All must serve the state, whether it be the highest person or the lowest person. Peasants are organized into these semi-militarized units. Feudal lords are replaced by bureaucracy. And everybody serves the king. Everybody serves the state. All the laws are applied equally to everybody. Xin Shi Huang Ti also believes that war is good. War makes the state stronger. War makes the king stronger. And war makes the people disciplined and submissive. Another big part of the Xin dynasty is the idea of standardization. The measurement of weights is standardized. The types of measurements used is standardized. The type of money used is standardized. The length and the size of axles for wagons is standardized. Even writing is standardized. Now, this dynasty is fairly short, and that's because Xin Shi Huang Ti is a megalomaniac. He's got some issues. He was afraid of assassination. He built numerous palaces. And these palaces were exact replicas of his defeated lords. He would put exact replicas or lookalikes in these palaces so that way if somebody tried to kill him, they probably wouldn't kill the right one. And he built this giant, fantastic tomb with hundreds of clay soldiers in it to protect him. And his dynasty basically self-destructed after his death. He died in 211 BC, and by 207 BC, warfare had broken out. And that leads us to the final dynasty we're going to talk about today, and that's the Han Dynasty. And they last from 206 BC to 221 AD. During that brief period of warfare after the death of Qin Shi Huangti, a peasant warrior named Liu Peng is going to become the winner of the war. That's going to be around 195 BC is when he dies. So he doesn't get to experience leadership for very long. But luckily, there are several good leaders who come after him. One of the best known is the Emperor Wu Ti. And Wu Ti is seen as the best emperor of the Han Dynasty. Wu Ti expanded the empire south into Vietnam, north into Korea, and west into Central Asia. And it is also during this time with Wu Ti that the Silk Road is established and trading happens between the Romans and the Chinese. Underneath the Han Dynasty, education becomes increasingly important. Academies are established to train future leaders, and those who are well educated become the ones who move up in society. Eventually, though, the Han Dynasty does fall. For whatever reason, there's this series of child emperors, and they can't control things because they're so young. There's increasing corruption, increasing taxes, and eventually there's a rebellion in the 200s where the kingdom falls apart and breaks into three parts. Now, there are three philosophers that we need to talk about that go with this lecture. The first one is Buddhism and Buddha. Buddha lived from either 563 to 483 or 480 to 400, depending on the source. And Buddha was originally known as Prince Siddhartha Gautama of India. And he lived in a palace his entire young life until he turned in his early 20s. He left the palace for the first time and realized that not everybody had life as well as he did. So he decided to meditate, and he came up with this idea that there were four noble truths. He said there's the truth of suffering, that everybody suffers for some reason. There's a cause to that suffering, there's a way to end the suffering, and there's a path that will set you free from the suffering. And this path is known as the Eightfold Path. He says you have to have the right understanding. You have to understand that you're suffering and there's a way to end it. You have to have the right thought. You have to have positive thoughts. You have to believe that you can end your suffering. There's right speech. You have to say the right things. You can't purposely hurt people with your speech. There's the right conduct. You have to live a good, moral, just life. There's the right means. You have to live within your means. You can't want for things you can't have or can't afford. There's the right attitude and the right effort. You have to work towards ending your suffering. And then there's right determination. You have to be determined. You can't give up. And then there's right concentration. And by that, he means meditation. You have to meditate on where your life is and where it's going. Now, Prince Siddhartha Gautama was a practicing Hindu, and this was an alternate path that he was giving on how to reach moksha. It is the students of Buddha who took his beliefs and created the religion today of Buddhism. And instead of just being an alternate way to reach moksha, followers of Buddhism believe that Buddha was actually giving you the way to nirvana, to spiritual release completely. Along with this is Confucius and Confucianism. Confucius lived from 551 to 479 BC, and he was a teacher, and this started out as a philosophy, and in many ways it has become a religion. The basics of the teachings of Confucius are morality, being a good, just person, proper behavior in relationships. In Chinese culture, the women respect the men respect the elders respect the ancestors, and everybody respects the king and the government. There's justice. You have to abide by the laws. You have to follow the laws. There's a respect for those that came before you, respect for your elders, respect for your ancestors. And overall, I mean, you could say it's this concept of a good man is involved and creates good government. Now, these beliefs, these practices are widely spread throughout China, and they're primarily accepted by those in the government and those in the upper class society. Think about it. It makes sense. Follow what the government says. Don't be a problem maker and do what you're told. On the other hand, we have Taoism, which was founded by a guy named Lao Tzu, and he wrote a book called the Tao Te Ching, or Book of the Way. And this was a book that was meant to teach on his sayings and to pass on his teachings. And Taoism is sometimes hard to explain. It's basically about balance. It's about going with the flow. It's about accepting things you can't change. It's about living at peace with yourself, living at peace with the world around you. Instead of fighting it against life, instead of fighting against others, just understand that you can't control some things. Instead of saying you're right all the time, admit that you can be wrong. Instead of being prideful, admit that you can learn from others. And instead of hanging on to tradition, admit that you can change. Now, this is going to be preferred by lower class people, primarily because the lower class people, the peasants, the farmers, they can't control what happens to their life. They have to go with the flow. Now, all three of these teachings, the teachings of Buddha, the teachings of Confucius, and the teaching of Lao Tzu, are going to blend together. And they affect the way the government works, they affect the way spiritual life works, and they affect daily life in China. And parts of this are still heavily seen in China today. All right, so that'll give you a basic overview of what early China looked like. Just real quick reminder to get your work done for this week. Remember, it's all due by 11:59 p.m. on Monday night. And also don't forget that we are getting ever closer to returning back to campus. So make sure you're checking your emails from your teachers and professors and keep an eye on that. Now, if you have any questions or concerns, just send me an email and I'll get back to you as quickly as I can. But for now, we'll see you later. Good night.